from Rice University. So in need of cash that Sammy the Owl is working birthday parties. It's general physics too. Today, current, and Ohm's law. Dr. Stenson. Also, a top 10 list. And now, a man who doesn't take any wooden nickels, unless they are recycled. Professor Hafner.
Alrighty then. Here we go. So, oh, shoot, hold on one second. I can't ever move. I've solved so many problems, and for some reason, I can't solve this one. Alright. I don't know what week it is. I've stopped paying attention. We're somewhere in the middle of the semester. We're talking about physics. There's an exam at one point. That's all I know. Okay, a quick recap. You see what I did there? So we've been talking about capacitors. We're going to say a few more things about capacitors. I also lost the chat. Let's just do a quick reminder about capacitors, and then we're going to talk a little bit about other things you can do with them. So a capacitor, recall, was just the way we described it, two conducting plates. You're looking at the plates in cross-section here. You know, in reality, they're coming out of the board. This is just our cartoon. And they have some surface area A, right? And they have some separation D. Yes, that's really all we need if we're gonna call it a capacitor. But just to make things interesting, we put a battery across them to give them some potential difference. That battery has a potential difference between its terminals EMF and connect a wire. And that means the two conductors also have a potential difference, EMF, E, because we know that a conductor has to have a constant potential on its surface. So you'd say this one is at plus E volts, and this one is at 0 volts by convention. And how does it do that? Because the battery flows charge, sends charge onto the plates, right? So charge, positive charge flows that way, negative charge flows that way. And it's tempting to look at this and say, well, Wyatt, if this is 0 volts, why is it charged? Remember, it's arbitrary what 0 volts is. So we say the negatively charged plate is at 0 volts. It's not the case that the battery sends positive charge here and sends zero here. Okay, the battery will always send equal and opposite charge in both directions. Okay. The battery remains neutral and does not charge up. Let's see, if we know all of that, then we can start to write our important equations over here, our most important equations. One is that the amount of charge on each plate, Q, is this quantity called the capacitance that describes this object times delta V. It's literally just how much charge does the capacitor hold for a certain voltage. That's really all it is. Chat back. There it is. We also learned how to calculate this capacitance. Okay, so C for this geometry is epsilon naught A over D. Okay, that's for a parallel plate capacitor. So you want to keep in mind any two conducting objects together make a capacitor. It doesn't have to be two parallel plates close to each other. You and I make a capacitor. I'm a conducting object, you're a conducting object. We're far apart, we're not very good conductors, but there is a capacitance between us that could be calculated. In fact, if you have someone that you're interested in getting to know better and you needed something to say to them, you might say, hey, I think maybe we ought to increase our capacitance. My hair sweats a good dielectric, I don't know. So you could think of something to say, implying, you know, the capacitance gets bigger as you get closer together, right? I'm also pointing this out to remind you that this is the only capacitor we're giving you the formula for, but sometimes in physics you use it even when something isn't exactly two parallel plates. Like when I had that capacitor rolled up, like the ones you use in the lab. It's a little cylinder. I showed you. You take it apart, unroll it. It's two big, long pieces kind of paper-like dielectric touching each other. So if you're talking about really the two electrodes in the paper, they are essentially parallel plates, but they're rolled up into a cylinder. If you want to calculate their capacitance, you wouldn't worry about the fact that they're rolled up into a cylinder. You'd say they're basically two parallel plates. So we just need to take the area of that whole unwrapped structure, and that would be the area we would put there, even though they're not exactly two parallel plates. If you think of them as two parallel plates rolled up, that's the area of each plate. So the plate problem, you have to do something similar. You have to think about, which area do I use here? Even though these aren't exactly two parallel square plates facing each other, you'll figure it out. All right, as long as the two surfaces are close together compared to whatever other geometry is going on, you treat it as a parallel plate. Is the area of the parallel plates the area of one plate or both? Ah, good question. Just one. It's just one plate, and it's just one plate's charge. Okay, so you don't double anything. What else we know? We know that if we stuck a dielectric in there, filled it with a dielectric, K, you just multiply K epsilon that A over D. So really, this is the general parallel plate capacitor. If there's nothing in there, that's vacuum or air, and K is one. So really, the form you can always put in the K, whatever. So the K increases the capacitance. We also, it's useful to remember that E field in the gap, it's actually two ways to get it. You could say, well, it's from the potential difference over D. That's kind of like our definition of the relationship between the E field and the potential difference in a uniform field, which is what's created in there. You could also get it from the charge densities and the charge density sigma over epsilon naught. This is, you know, from Gauss's law. In that chapter we didn't do because there's a lot of calculus involved. How will we know if something is a conductor or insulator without being told so? We will tell you. We will tell you. And then finally, there was the energy. How much energy is stored in a capacitor? Because you could say a capacitor's job is to store charge, but equivalently, it's also storing energy. When are Dr. Hafner's office hours today? I saw 1 p.m. one place and 4:30 the other place. So on the front page of the website, it says it's 4:30. They're at 4:30. I use one link to make it easier, and in Zoom, it says it's at 1. I guess I can make two different Zoom links, and to me, it's an equal, it's conservation of confusion. So yeah, so it's at 4:30 today. 4:30 on Thursdays, always 4:30 on Thursdays. I teach intro physics. It's a constant conservation of confusion. If it looks like, why doesn't he do it this other way? Just as much confusion that way. Conservation of confusion. I've just made it a law. We'll talk about laws in a minute. Okay, so what is the energy stored by a capacitor? We went through and decided it was 1/2 Q times delta V. If you think you're doing well in this class and you really understand things, you probably thought it was Q times delta V. But if you go back to that lecture, I convinced you no, it's actually 1/2, which equivalently is C times delta V squared, which equivalently is 1/2 Q squared over C. These are all the same thing. All we're doing is saying, instead of expressing it in terms of Q and delta V, I could use this thing and express it in C and delta V or Q and C. It's the same thing. So you can use these or just memorize one and use these or get them off your formula sheet or whatever you want to do. This is the energy stored. So those were the capacitor basics. We went over the formulas. You know, it gets much more complicated if you go beyond parallel plate capacitors, but that's all we're doing, parallel plates. Okay, so what we want to do now, we have one more little capacitor thing before we move on to current resistors. And that is what happens when you combine capacitors. Let's combine capacitors. All right. So you may have noticed that this was on the homework, Canvas homework 7.6 and 7.7, even though I didn't talk about it, even though it's due tonight, because Canvas homework 6 and 7 are designed to guide you through the thought process, to learn and understand how to combine capacitors, okay? And normally I do that in the lectures, but outside there, we don't have time. I just give you the formula, give it to you in one sentence, and then how to use it. And I will let Canvas homework 6 and 7 be where you walk through and learn the physics behind how you combine capacitors, okay? Or you could read about it in the book, right? Everything I'm saying, I'm not making this up, right? I'm not discovering physics as we go along. There's a lot of books that have this in it, so you can also look there. So now I'm going to just tell you the answer. What if we had 3 capacitors like that? There's one, there's one, and there's one. 3 capacitors, C1, C2, and C3. This is the circuit diagram for a capacitor. I think it's self-explanatory. 2 parallel lines are the plates, and these are the wires coming off the plates. Okay, we have 3 of them, 3 different capacitances. So one way you could combine them is you could just wire them up. Connect these 2 wires on that plate and these 2 wires on that plate. Then some physics becomes apparent. Based on what we know about electrostatics, the potential of this plate is the same as the potential of that plate. And the potential of that plate is the same as the potential of that plate. See, there's ways you could work through the physics, and that's what Canvas homework 7.6 and 7 are designed to have you do. But if we combine them that way, so what? Well, the question is, what is the equivalent capacitance of this thing? And the way to get that is to imagine you're the battery, okay? So you're the battery, and you got your 2 electrodes. I'm gonna put positive on this side this time, just to keep you thinking here. And we hook this wire to the positive electrode, and we hook this wire to the negative electrode. And the battery is putting out some EMF like that. So, well, we know this is plus EMF on that plate, and this is 0 volts. I'll put volts so you know what I'm talking about. That's the symbol, that's the unit, and 0 volts on that plate. And something happens in the middle, okay? The way we mathematically describe this is we say, what is the Ceq equals the equivalent capacitance? Okay, so we're not going to walk through every bit of the physics. I've decided I'll just give you the answer, but I want to tell you what the equivalent capacitance means. It's like, what capacitance does the battery think is there? Okay, the battery is not sentient. The battery doesn't have sensory organs like eyes, and it can't look at this and say, oh, it's 3 capacitors in series. 3 capacitors in series. Let me send out this much charge, okay? It can't do that. It doesn't have a calculator. It's just a battery. All it knows is, I gotta send out enough charge to hold the EMF and E. That's all it knows, okay? So it sent out some charge here, and it sent out some negative charge here, and it holds it at E, EMF. That's all it knows, okay? So according to the battery, the charge that it sent out, we could call it Q battery. Here, let's call it Q battery. Battery equals what? The equivalent capacitance of whatever is there times the EMF, whatever it put out. That's all it knows. So we just want to know mathematically what's the relationship between the equivalent capacitance the battery thinks is there and what's really there. And when they're added in series, it looks like this. It's like resistors if you've done little circuits in high school or growing up in circuit camp or whatever you people did, I don't know. 1 over C1 plus 1 over C2 plus 1 over C3. And if there were more of them, plus 1 over C4, plus 1 over C5, etc. So they add sort of as inverses. So the more of them you put, the less capacitance you get. Mm-hmm. And you may wonder why. It's basically because they're all getting the same charge, but they're having to divide up the voltage, right? So same charge, the less voltage, go through Kevin's homework, 7.6, I'm saying it backwards. But this is the idea. So you add them up this way, okay? We'll do one in a minute, don't worry. We're gonna do a practice, okay? Another way, Another way you could do it is parallel. Okay, so let me draw parallel real quick. parallel. And let's look at parallel. I'm going to keep some of my drawing. There we go. I'm going to add my three in parallel. Everything else is the same. It's like the battery is like, I don't know, I just see. So there's one like that. This one, no, it's good enough. So that would be, there you go. There's an awkward way to just draw one capacitor, right? But there's not just one, that's C1. There's also, am I shorting these capacitors? Oh my God, did I even have it? Let me draw it the normal way. I don't want to confuse you geometrically. Let's flip them over. I don't know why I can't draw this. Here we go. Okay, yes, capacitor. And we'll put these over here. There we go. There's a better way to draw that. I don't know why I'm drawing it so stupid. Let's see. Here's another way to draw it. No, I can't draw better. I've got to draw them sideways. I can't make myself draw it sideways. Draw the lines like this. Okay, I can't do it. Anyway, here are three capacitors in parallel. And you can see the difference is they all have plus E on this side, right? Because this wire has to be all at EMF. E, high EMF, high EMF, high EMF. This one has to all be at 0V. 0V, 0V, 0V. So hopefully you fundamentally see the difference. When they're in series, the potential is stepping down as you go through them. When they're in parallel, they all get the same EMF, all right? And again, the battery doesn't know what's going on. The battery isn't laughing at my pathetic attempt to draw parallel resistors. I don't know why I can't draw parallel resistors well. It just knows that there's some equivalent capacitance. So mathematically, how do we add it up here? C equivalent for parallel, you just add 1 plus C2 plus C3. Yeah. And the reason you can see a little bit intuitively why this works is just get them closer together. It's really like it's just one capacitor. If you let them touch, you would just be adding the areas of their plates. And if you add the areas of the plates, you're just adding the capacitance. I think in the homework, it's drawn like this. Here's the two electrodes. Yeah. I guess that's the more battery-centric way to draw it. Yeah. So you can see it's holding one side of the capacitors at one potential, the other side at the other potential. It's essentially just like it's turning it to one big capacitor. And instead of having to share the charge, right, each one has its own charge. Right? That's physically why it's fundamentally different. Again, go through the Canvas homework. That walks you through every little calculation to see the physics of why this is. Okay, so parallel capacitors just add. Do you have to win the series capacitor parallel ones again? Series, okay, parallel. All the plates on one side are at E, all the plates on the other side are at 0. Series, the left plate of the left capacitor was E, the right plate of the right capacitor was 0, and the plates in between are different potentials. They have to make their way down from EMF to 0. That's what you'll be convinced of when you do Canvas homework 6 and 7. But this is like 126. Other people just want the formula. Oh, okay. If you want the real deal, I will whip out my old lectures, play them. Anyway, that's the fundamental difference. It's just how they divide up the charge and how they divide up the potential. So yeah, that's what's in that homework. But let's use these formulas for a minute. Just see how it works. Here we go. Let's say we have 3, 5 microfarad capacitors. And the question is, how many CEQ can you make? And what values? What could you do? What if I said, make me the highest capacitance you can possibly make? Let's do that one first. What's the highest? Oh, I don't know. You're just going to guess. You're going to say, well, there's series and parallel. Now let's do parallel first. You can say, okay, he had that horrible drawing. there's a 5, there's a 5, and there's a 5. And if you don't know how to draw that, you don't worry, you just use a formula. But this is the idea. There's parallel, they're each getting the battery EMF. You have to think about the battery though, because we have the formula for parallel, right? So the capacitance, the equivalent of that is just 5 plus 5 plus 5 plus 5 plus 5, 15 microfarads. So that's one of them. And if it's not clear to you yet that that's the biggest one, I wouldn't expect it to be because you just learned this 45 seconds ago. But you can also just do a bunch of things and you'll find this is the biggest one. So parallel is one case. Well, I guess series would be another case. Right? We could say, let's put them in series. See, now how they share the charge and potential will be different. Right? So what's the equivalent capacitance of that? It'd be wild to not even draw the battery, because it doesn't depend on the battery. Right? Capacitance is just a problem. Are those old lectures are on YouTube? Yes, I have about 1,400 videos on YouTube. So look for, just search my name on YouTube. They're actually organized, you can find it. Let's see, 5, blah, blah, blah. I mean, I made online classes. I did not personally make 1,400 videos. Other people, I mean, I was there anyway. Don't you think that's like all I do all day? 5, 5, and 5. So 3 in series, what is it? 1 over CEQ equals 1 over 5 plus 1 over 5 plus 1 over 5. All right. What is CEQ? Oh, well, that is 3 over 5. Remember in your middle school, why do I have to learn to add fractions? Here, this is the reason. They were getting you ready for today. So you say 3/5 must be the answer, but no, that's 1 over CEQ. So flip it over, and it's 5/3. Yeah, so CEQ is 5/3, which is 1.67 microfarads. Okay. And I wouldn't expect you to know this when you, this is all new to you, but that's the lowest. That's the lowest you're gonna get. One question was, how many can you make? Can you think of a way to make another one? You got 3. We can mix series and parallel. Yes, we can make different kinds of combinations. For example, what if we put 2 in parallel? Ooh, look at me draw parallel. Baby's first lecture, look at that. These two are in parallel. Why are they in parallel? Look for a case where the wire splits and 2 plates have to be at the same potential, right? These 2 plates have to be at the same potential on this side. They have to be at the same potential on that side. That's why those are parallel. And they're in series with this one, right? It's not the case that these plates have to be the same as that plate, or these are the same as that, right? This plate, the same as these two, sure, but this one is not the same as these two. So these are in series, or this is in series with these two. So the way you calculate that is you kind of have to do it in steps. First, you want the equivalent of the parallel part. Right? Let's call them A, B, and C. So you'd say 1 over capacitance of A and B is 1 over the capacitance. I'm sorry, those are in parallel. The wrong problem. You'd say the capacitance of A and B is the capacitance of A plus the capacitance of B, right? These two are in parallel. So you just add them. Why do series capacitors have lower CEQs? Yeah, that's just the way it is. Right? Canvas homework 7, 6, and 7. It's because here, each of these 5 microfarad capacitors is getting a full Q. Here, they have to divide it up. It's more that their potentials are different, I'm sorry. Here, each of the capacitors is getting the full EMF. Here, they're having to divide up the EMF. Okay, if this has to be at EMFE, and this has to be at 0, these are gonna have to be somewhere in between. So none of them are gonna be at the full EMF. They're gonna divide it up. Here we were saying this branch is equal to 10 microfarads, 5 plus 5. All right. So then what we effectively have is we have a 10 and C, 5 in series. Okay. 10 and 5 in series. So I'll solve that in the corner here and then we'll move over. So then the total 1 over CEQ is 1 over 10 plus 1 over 5. Okay, so you add that up and you get, that's 2 over 10 plus 1 is 3 over 10. Flip it over and you get 10 over 3. So you get 3.3333. So this one is 3.33 microfarads. Okay. So it's somewhere in between. Like the most you can make is 15, the least you can make is 1.67. If you start making little combinations, you get values in between. But the main thing to see from there is that this idea of calculating an equivalent capacitance, you can apply to little parts of the circuit to break a circuit down. Okay. There is one more. Shall we? Of course we shall. Let's see if we put two in parallel one in series, we can probably do the opposite. We can put two in series. Ooh, I was writing my name for a second. Me. And now we gotta put one in parallel with those. Like that. There we go. So 5, 5, 5 microfarads. How are we gonna deal with that? Well, I would say step one is CEQ of the two in series first, right? Here we're gonna do series first, and then we put that one in parallel with that one. Yeah. So that's gonna be 1 over C equals 1 over 5 plus 1 over 5. All right, so these two, this time I'll draw it on here. And I'll put a little thingy. This will help you later when you're looking at your notes. The capacitor is, of those two is 2 over 5. Flip it over, 5 over 2, 2.5 microfarads. So for the whole thing, we have 2.5 microfarads in parallel. Let's see, I'm curious if I get the same answer. I didn't finish it. 2.5 in parallel with 5. So the CEQ of the whole thing, we're taking little shortcuts here, we can't do this all day, is 2.5 plus 5 is 7.5 microfarads. All right. So we had 15, we had 7.5, we had 3.33, we had 1.67, and that's it. I can think of one more. Anybody think of one more? While I'm erasing, can anyone think of one more? Think if there's any other way to combine them without breaking them. Here's one more. Don't connect them. And then what's the capacitance? Somebody put in the capacitance. What's the chat? And yes, I am setting you up. Oh, no, I'm not setting you up. Never mind. Yes, it's zero. Right. So you're going to also make zero by not even combining them. Yeah. Whatever. Yeah. So that last one was just being silly. Of course, you have to connect them. Okay. I'm putting these pauses in there for you to catch up. I'm not having mental moments. Okay, so that's really it for capacitors. We'll get back to them because we're gonna start putting them in circuits later a little bit. Now we have to talk about the more famous circuit issue, and that is when we start putting like resistors in circuits, things like that. So what we're gonna have to start doing is let's look at circuits. Let's put conductors on the battery. All right, so we have a battery here. And what was the battery's job? The battery's job was to hold a constant EMF across those terminals. All right, so let's just put a conductor on there. But what did we learn about conductors? we learned that their surface has to be an equipotential, has to have constant potential. We pulled it off for the capacitors because there's that gap, right? So one side can be zero. But here we can't do that because this has to be constant, this has to be EMF, and this has to be zero. So what are we going to do? So I'm going to show you a quick video of one time when I broke the laws of physics and lived to tell about it.
What we're going to do now is we're going to break the laws of physics. Now, it's a little bit risky and scary to break the laws of physics. You never know what's going to happen. But we're going to break them somehow because we're going to set something up where two laws can't be true at the same time. The laws of physics and chemistry require that the terminals of the battery be at a different potential. But we also talked about how in a conductor, the surface has to be all at the same potential, right? Because it goes, all the electrons will move to make the surface all be at a constant potential. That's in fact why each terminal on the battery has to be completely at 9 volts and completely at 0 volts. Okay? We're going to do this with a little bit larger battery so you can see it better. So this is a 12 volt battery. Here's its two terminals. So this one is negative, we can call that 0. This one's positive, we can call that plus 12 volts. And this is our metal. So this is iron wire. It's 75 microns in diameter, so it's about the diameter of a human hair. You can't quite see it very well in the video, but I promise you that there's wire there. How else would I do this? There is wire there. There is wire there, okay? So I'm gonna take this metal wire and I'm gonna place it across the terminals of the battery. So we're somehow breaking the laws of physics. We can't have this be at 9 volt or 12 volts, this be at 0 volts, and this all be at the same, because we're gonna make one essentially large conductor. So let's see what happens when we do it, okay? It's very exciting. Okay, here we go. I'm really gonna do it this time, okay. Here we go. What happens when you break the laws of physics? Oh, whoa. The universe gets very upset when you break its laws of physics. Let's try again. Maybe the universe was just having a bad day. Let's make sure that's really the outcome of this. So we bring it down, and is it gonna be 0 volts, 9 volts, 12 volts? What's it gonna be? The universe says, nope. Can't exist, has to go away. So the answer is no, apparently this, you just can't do this, right? So it's impossible. So we have to figure out what's going on. Well, as I alluded to in our discussion of what's happening with the metal plates in a capacitor, whenever something looks wrong in physics, there's always an answer. You can always figure it out. And almost every time, the answer is you deviated from your model, right? There's always some condition. Anytime you say something, there's always a condition, there's always a model. Well, here we have once again deviated from our model, and the way we've deviated is that we are no longer in electrostatics. Remember, the surface of a metal has to be at a constant potential in electrostatic equilibrium. And in this experiment, we are no longer in electrostatic equilibrium.
All right, so yes, the trick is when you're doing circuits, you're not doing electrostatics. Things are changing. So those little rules I told you about the field around a metal and the potential on the surface doesn't apply to circuits. So what is the most interesting thing? That's a relative question. The most interesting thing going on in the circuit, and I would say, for the purpose of teaching this class, I would say that there is current. Current in the circuit. What is current? It's the flow of charge, right? You guys, flow means something interesting to you, right? It's got flow. Usually, in pretty much every circuit you're gonna deal with, well, not if you do biology, usually electrons in a metal, because a metal is a conductor. So remember our discussion of conductors, some of the electrons are free to flow around, and that's how, so what's the takeaway from the conductor on a battery experiment? That's what I said. It's just that you don't hold a constant potential when you let current flow, because obviously we have to have a potential across, and you'll see in a minute. Flow of charge, usually electrons in a metal, but also ions in solution. Or if some of you say, I want to become like a space physicist, it can also be charged particles in space, like the solar wind you can describe with a current. Space. All right. So there's three kinds, those are probably the main three kinds of currents. 99.9%, not everything. In our class, we'll talk mostly about current in a metal, like a circuit, but we'll also talk about ions in solution a little bit, because that's how your nervous system works. Let's see, so let's diagrammatically look at current in a conducting wire, all right? So there is a three-dimensional cylinder, thank you. And what I'm gonna do is like hook it up to a battery. So this is the plus V side and this is the minus V side. Okay, I'm not saying EMF or which one is zero, just saying this is high potential and this is low potential. The way I've drawn it here, the potential difference across this piece of wire is 2V, there to there. Somebody was asking me in office hours, a very good question. Wait, potential difference, is it positive or negative? I mean, which high to low, low to high, where's start, finish? So in circuits, often potential difference in voltage and voltage drop is used loosely, and it means the magnitude of the potential difference. And we usually often don't think about the direction, whether it's negative or not. Sometimes we do, and sometimes we don't. So you just gotta deal with it. If you look in the details of physics books, they actually switch the definition in the circuit chapter to make this not come up. And I don't know if they're trying to make it less confusing for the student and trick them, or if the person writing the book doesn't actually know. I'm not sure. Might be one author wrote this chapter, one author wrote that chapter. I don't know. But I can show you in several books where they switched the limits on the integral to make the voltage drop positive. And they don't clarify it at all, and it's kind of funny. Anyway, enough shop talk. What's gonna happen to the electrons? Those are the free charges in this wire. They're gonna move towards the higher potential. Right, this is at higher potential because you think, well, there's like some positive charge up here. This sort of electrostatics would have created a field from high to low potential, pointing that way because of high. So the electrons are going to move that way, okay? And they're going to drift that way at some velocity. So you get all these electrons, negative electrons, moving this way towards higher potential. They're all moving at some drift velocity like that, okay? So, but that's not the current. The current goes this way, okay? So this is all because of like Benjamin Franklin or whoever it was that made electrons negative, screwed it up, because it's electrons that do most of the moving in a current. So electrons should have been positive, but it got defined wrong before we knew how current worked. So current is this way, electron flow is that way, okay? So the current that we define is delta Q over delta T when we're considering some cross-section. Let me erase that electron and draw a little cross-sectional area here. So it's the delta Q delta over delta T, and delta Q is the charge across the cross-sectional area. Okay, we'll do more bullets to clarify this in a second. But let's go ahead and just say the unit in coulombs is the unit of charge per second, which is the unit of time, which is equal to an ampere, which is equal to an amp, which we abbreviate with a big A. Okay, so the MKS unit for current is the amp, big A. Okay, so one bullet is this. So let's just say it this way. So current is really the, here's an old-fashioned word, flux. Flux across a surface. All right. The surface is just a little cross-sectional perpendicular area. Does the area have to be perpendicular? Well, there's a way we could prove that it doesn't. Yes, if we got into the mathematical definition of flux, there's a dot product and an integral, and you could make it crooked. But if you don't want to do that, which you don't, just imagine it, a perpendicular area inside the wire. Otherwise, we're doing vector calculus. Okay, so the direction is the flow of positive charge from high to low potential. All right. Or you can just say, don't even worry about charge. It's just from high to low potential. Okay. If you showed me this wire with electrons going that way and said, which way is the current? I would say it's got to be this way. Negative charge flowing that way, it's got to be the opposite way. If you showed me this wire and didn't put anything about charges on it and said, that's high potential, that's below potential, which way is the current? It's got to be that way. Because I don't know what's happening in this wire, but if there were free positive charges flowing, they would flow that way. So that's why the current has to be that way. Okay, so you can think of it in terms of microscopic charge moving, depends on their charge and which way they're moving. Or if you know potential, get it from potential. Okay, so to stress this one more time, all equations and definitions, all equations and definitions assume the current is the flow of positive charge, even if it isn't. We don't care what's really happening, okay? All we, you know, if you calculate this many electrons go across that thing per second and you get a number for the current, that's great, but if you want the direction, it's the other way, okay? We don't, this isn't like a thing that's gonna come up with lots of gotcha questions all the time, okay? But it is, sometimes it comes up and you do have to understand the difference in the direction of the two. All right, so why don't we, let's see, flux positive charges, would delta Q always include a charge for the charge for a, yeah, so this number is always, oh, okay, depends how deep we want to get. Okay, final minus initial, yada, yada, yes, this is always positive. So yeah, this is where, so if it sounds like being vague and arbitrary, it's because we are doing, you know, a quick version of something that needs to be described with detailed calculus. So when you ask me some questions, I go, I can't, it's hard for me to say the approximate version. And then conservation of confusion, right? Some people want to hear the detailed version. Some people won't even, it'll never occur to them the detailed difference, but some people it will, and they'll be up at night thinking, why did he confuse me? Conservation of confusion. Is it a theory or a law? I don't know. Speaking of theories and laws, we're going to talk about those after the break. Enjoy something. I'll see you at 10:27.
It's time for the top 10 signs you've made it in academia. So I hope that some of you are so inspired by this class that you decide to become a professor. I think we've got some bioscience, some comp sci people in there. Could happen. If you do, I want to make sure you know when you've made it. So you can always refer back to this list. Here we go. Number 10. When you speak, they introduce the person who introduces you. You may have noticed this at fancy lectures that someone has to introduce and then that person, you know, you get it. Also, it counts as if you're the person who is going to introduce someone, but you have to be introduced. Also means you made it. Number 9, a closet full of black turtlenecks. Number 8, a private bathroom in your office. Number 7, chit-chat with your colleagues rapidly devolves into comparative analysis of frequent flyer lounges. A big part of academia is flying around the world and giving talks. It means you're very important. And I've actually been in conversations that have lasted probably for an hour of just naming and commenting on frequent flyer lounges. Yeah. Apparently the United Lounge in Stuttgart is to die for. Number 6, the department chair doesn't even ask you to do stuff anymore. Number 5, you have to use a velvet rope when you lecture. Number 4, you introduce yourself to your grad students at their thesis defense. Uh-oh. Number 3, you actually understand how the university budget works. If somebody could explain to me what depreciation is and how I can use it to my advantage, would really help. I have 20 years I've tried to understand what depreciation, I have no idea. But that's why I haven't made it. All right, number 2. You gave a TED talk even though you don't work in technology, entertainment, or design. And the number 1 sign you've made it in academia, you don't teach intro physics.
right. Okay, I'm very nervous about the comments about a list because I don't know what list. let's see. All right, so where were we? Yes, we were talking about, I actually completely lost my train of thought in 3 minutes. We talked about current one, the V equals IR, and I even in the wrong place. I'll edit this out. Yes, current. Yes, okay. So we've talked about just sort of a fundamental definition of current as the flow of charge across a plane, like a cross-sectional area. I just gotta get going. I'm gonna warm up. Let's look at the microscopic description of current. So by the time I'm through with this board, you're going to have two equations to tell you what the current is, which may annoy you. One is like the fundamental definition, delta Q over delta T. The second is kind of like how you would describe it in a metal, where you have a bunch of charge carriers at some density, you know, things like that. So let's imagine we have a little piece of a wire here. And just like we said before, you can imagine it's got this cross-sectional area A, like that. And you've got these charge carriers. And like I implied before, they're just drifting along. It's something called V drift area of the cross section. And VD is the drift velocity of the charge carriers. Okay, drift velocity of the charge carriers. And let's see. So what we're going to do is start with our definition and see if we can describe it in terms of the behavior of these charge carriers. Right, that's the idea. So we know that the current flowing through there is delta Q, little q, over delta T. Okay. How would we describe how much charge flowed across that area in a certain amount of time? Well, one thing we'd want to realize is if they're moving and we know how fast they're moving, we can do a little bit of kinematics. We can know that in time delta T, they might get to here. Right? So we have this distance delta X, and they get there in time delta T. So in time delta T, they drift how much? Delta X equals V drift delta T, okay? So then we say in some time, how many charges cross? It's really just the amount of charge in that volume, okay? So what we could say is that delta Q is the charge in the volume swept in delta T. And the volume we're referring to is there. Right, in this big volume here. So we could say then that I is that delta Q. So what is that amount of charge? It is related to that volume. The volume that crosses the plane times the volume times the carrier density times the charge of each carrier. So I know this is getting a little messy, but this is just sort of a word equation for you in delta T. So see if that makes sense to you. The volume here, carrier density means like how many electrons per, how many conduction electrons per meter cubed or per liter, right? Because if you multiply those two, you're going to get how many are in here. But then it's not just counting them, it's also their charge. So you'd have the charge of each carrier. You put all that together. So let's start putting that together mathematically and see what happens. What is the volume of this? Well, it's A times delta X. A delta X. What is the density of these charge-carrying divided little particles? Well, that's just a number we call N. It's not something we're going to calculate. We're going to give it to you. It's different for every material. And what is the charge of each electron? Well, for an electron, we know it's fundamental E. Let's just call it Q, though. Oh, Q is a bad choice because we called that delta Q. Why did I write Q? Probably because it says that in your book. I'm going to put Q with a little C kind of subscript on there. It means of the carrier, charge of the carrier. QC equals charge of the carrier. And carrier just means the things, you know, carrying the current, all the particles that are moving. In a metal, it's usually an electron. Over delta T. Right? So this doesn't look very useful or helpful. But what we're going to do is we're going to plug in for delta X. Equals A. Delta X is that drift velocity. Delta T in Q, all right, over delta T, and then you see that's when the magic happens, right? So the delta T's go away. That's the reason we set it all up that way. So what you get is that the current, and the way it's usually written is, I'll reorder these a little bit, is the charge of the carrier, QC, the density of the carriers, N, the cross-sectional area of the wire, A, and the drift velocity, D. So this is like the microscopic description. If you're doing a problem just about how much charge goes across this in time, you may just need delta Q over delta T. This is the definition. But if you're doing a problem where you're actually keeping up with the charge carriers and counting them, etc., then, the top 10 list. Okay, it finally hit me. QCNAB. Okay. This is microscopic description. Okay. So now we're going to do a little problem that will let us think about these two. All right. Here we go. Let's ask ourselves the following. What if we had a wire that suddenly gets thinner? So here it has a diameter of 5, and it can be centimeters if that makes you feel better. And here it has a diameter of 1 centimeter. Okay? And a current flows through. Okay. I don't expect you to necessarily know exactly what's going to happen yet. That's why we're going through this. We'll point out a few more things about current. But we could ask ourselves, you know, the following question is, how will I change? Okay, well, I'm just getting older. We're all just getting older. How will the current change from the large wire to the thin wire? And how will one of those microscopic properties change? Let's go with the drift velocity change. Because if you think about the microscopic one, well, you know, I mean, the area is obviously changing. So the other thing on there that's interesting is the drift velocity. But we'll get to that in a minute. Okay, so how will current change? Well, you may not know about this yet, but let me tell you one more fact about current. Is that I'll say the charge carriers, the electrons or the ions in solution or whatever it is, charge carriers act like an, you ready for this, incompressible fluid. It's one of those times where it's useful to have been here for 125. If you aren't, you're going to be fine. If you weren't, you're going to be fine. But the idea is the charge carriers, one, if it's an incompressible fluid, they're conserved. So you can't just have them disappear. The number of charge carriers is constant. And they can't compress like a gas. They have to hold the same volume. So now let's think about this again. How will the current change? So question A and question B. Question A, it won't. How about remains constant? Anywhere in that wire, whether you're here, current, 2 amps, 2 amps, 2 amps, 2 amps, 2 amps, 2 amps, it's going to remain constant. Okay. Same charge, delta Q, is flowing over this in a certain time. This is flowing over that at a certain time. Why? Well, I mean, you think, well, it can't cram. How can it get us more through there? It doesn't have a choice. It's like, you know, this is still coming. You can't have it build up, okay? Because it's an incompressible fluid, and it's conserved. Can't disappear. Okay, so charge remains constant, or the current remains constant. Well, if the current remains constant, let's write that equation again to answer B. We know that I is constant. It can't change for either side. So what was it again? It was Q times the density times the area times the drift velocity. Okay, so that can't change from here to here. So something's got to give. All right, so we know the area is going down. Something has to go up. Something. Okay, could the fundamental charge on each charge carrier go up? No. Right, they're electrons. That is a constant of the universe. Even if they're ions in solution, it's a constant of the universe. So that leaves the density of carriers and their speed, how fast they're going. Okay. If you look at the microscope division, it'll say that the current decreases. Oh, you were just answering the question. Current decreases going from larger to. Yeah, no, I'm explaining that now. Yeah. So the point is, the current has to be the same. Things change microscopically. Yes. And you'll know which one to use when the problem, like if the problem says, what's the drift velocity? Then you use a microscope. Okay, so if that went down, something has to go up. Q can't go up. Could the density of charge carriers go up? If we were treating this like a gas, they could, right? In a gas, you can have particles of a certain density and you can squeeze it to a smaller density, but you have to compress it to do that. And they act like an incompressible fluid. So this actually has to stay the same. And you may think physically, well, why can't they get closer together? And this is extremely fundamental point that doesn't really matter in your understanding of the class much, but it's useful to know that these charge carriers are not extra charges we're putting in the wire as though we're charging it up, okay? These charge carriers are the electrons that keep the metal neutral. It's just that, you know, you have positive ion core, you have some negative valence electron, or what should core electrons, okay? And then you have these outer conduction electrons that are free to move, but you need them all there to be negative, okay? So a wire carrying a current is not like charged up, it's still neutral. And you can't, if you were to take, you know, cram a bunch more electrons in here, something like this would be really charged up, it would be coulombs of charge, big problem, okay? So that's why you think of the charge carriers, the free electrons in a metal, as an incompressible fluid. So if you have a fluid, a certain, you know, volume per second flowing here, you know, liters per minute flowing here, the same liters per minute have to flow here, then V, right? This has to go up. That's the answer. VD is faster. So just imagine the little particles drifting along when they go in here, just like a fluid would do, they go a lot faster. How much faster? Oh, well, then we could use this. We could say, let's do left, right. We could say those have to be equal. The current has to be equal left and right. All right, so on the left, what do we got? We got Q. That's going to be the same. We got N. It's going to be the same. What about pi? Pi times the radius, 2.5 squared. I'm not being careful with units here because everything's going to cancel. I've done this before, all right? And then the VD left, all right? What about the right side? Same Q, same N, because it's the same material. Pi, 0.5 squared times VD right. Look at that board usage, unbelievable. All right, so a bunch of stuff's gonna cancel. It's really just a ratio problem, right? The Q is the end of pi's. All right, so if you want the ratio of like, oh, I wrote it out, VD, right, or VDL. How much faster is the right moving than the left? Then it'd be basically 2.5 squared over 0.5 squared. It's the square of the difference in the radii or the diameter. So it's 25. So 25. So it speeds up by a factor of 25. in the thin wire? So that'd be the kind of a question. Or it could be a quantitative question where you actually plug in numbers for all these things to get an actual number for this drift velocity. For that, of course, you would need n, and we'll give you a table of n's later. I didn't happen to put one in my notes, sorry. But there's a table in the book, and we would give you any n's that you need. The numbers are really big. And you can imagine if you want to get a typical number in MKS units here, typical number, really small charge in coulombs for an electron. So you need a really large number here to get typical numbers. And of course, there are a lot of electrons per meter cubed in matter. Okay, that's the basic idea of current. You only have to think about two definitions, the fundamental and then the microscopic description. And we played with it a little bit. It decreases, yeah. Okay, now, the next little topic, and then that's, you know, we'll do some ohm and then head towards circuits here. The next little topic is something called Ohm's law. We're going to use this current in an idea. So when you were a child a few years ago, right, you're in some elementary school science class, right, and they tell you that the way science works is you have a theory, right, and then you test the theory. And if a lot of theories or a lot of tests confirm that the theory is correct, then it's a law. And that's the difference between a theory and a law. That's completely wrong. It's almost perfectly backwards, okay? Because if you look at how physics or science really works and how these things are really called, all the things that are definitely true, we still call theories, general relativity theory, special theory, relativity, theory of evolution. And then things that got called laws, you don't know yet, but most of them are bullshit, basically. Ohm's law. So, and the reason is, it's a little bit deep, because, you know, if you understand how science works, you know that if something you test and it's true, then yeah, okay, it's always true. But tomorrow there could be a test that says it's not true anymore. And then you say, okay, that's not true. Let's work on something new. So really, we should never have things we call laws. Everything is probably going to be wrong eventually, okay? So that's why the big things, most of us still call them theories. Maybe it's just a momentum that they still call them theories. But you'll look, the big ones, theory of gravitation, yeah, usually still called theories. So why would you call anything a law? You call something a law if you're like a self-promoter. If you don't really have anything fundamental or basic or important to say, so you just come up with something that's kind of true and you call it a law. It's like a PR kind of a thing, okay? So that's what Ohm's law is. So I refuse to call it a law. Ohm's law is not a law. Ohm just wanted people to think he was important. It's Ohm's observation that was relevant to materials in 1827. That's what this is, okay? Ohm's observation. And what he observed in some materials and decided to call a law was that if he took a material, you know, like this, and put a battery across it, and put various EMFs on one side and the other side, he would find that, yeah, he can get current flow, and he can measure that current flow. And he found that if he, you know, increase the EMF here, I'll call it delta V just to make it match, right? He's applying a potential difference delta V, and he measured the current over here, that it basically would make a line, right? Do the lab experiment, get a line, R equals one, right? And he said, okay, there's a law. Everything makes a line, okay? Almost nothing makes a line. Nothing actually makes a line. A lot of things make things that are really close to a line, right? A conductor, to the best you could possibly measure it in a freshman physics lab, it's a line. These aren't varying temperature or the amount of current. You know, you do get anything will give you small deviations from a line. So it's really just an approximation that this is true. But the formula used to describe it then is Ohm's law. The formula delta V is IR. Or at least this is the way there's a more general form we'll get to, I think. But this is the basic idea, V equals IR. If you apply a voltage across a material, you'll get a current that's proportional to the voltage you apply with some proportionality constant. If you do it like you would do in a lab, it's actually the slope of this equals 1 over r. The way you'd want to plot it here, y equals mx, is you'd put delta v on the y. But we usually, for some reason, because we dial in the v, we put that down here. Because we measure the I, we put it up here. The slope of the IV curve is 1 over r, where r is the resistance in ohms. You've got the unit, bastard. And the other thing, ohm. Oh, it's omega. That never occurred to me before. So if your last name sounds kind of like a Greek letter, and you're willing to just lie and call something a law, that's how you get something named after you. FYI, ohm had two laws. He also has a law in acoustics. Something about the sound sounds twice as high, the frequency is twice as high, and it's also known to be not really true. So he did it twice. He did it in electronics and in acoustics. Okay? Just say what you do as a law, and you will have your own law. Let's see. So, but let's think deeply for a minute about if this even makes any sense at all. Okay? Apply, let's go microscopic for a minute here. Delta V to a conductor. And we're just going to try to get a little physical insight. Okay, what if we had a conductor like this? And we apply delta V to it, you know, with a battery. Say here, we're on the battery again. All right, delta V. So we could say, you know, plus, minus, we could say this is at plus V, and this is at zero. Plus V, V, plus V volts, and zero volts, okay? So what would happen? So we've gotten over the idea that, oh my God, the universe is gonna blow up. We accept now that the potential can drop across the material, because a current will flow. So let's even think further back what will happen. And let's just, for our own sanity, pretend the charge carriers are positive, okay? So if we had a charge carrier in this metal and for some reason we're positive, what will happen here? We have plus V here, we have zero here. You're creating an electric field in the metal. And now let's ask, what will happen to that positive charge carrier? You'll feel a force. F equals QE. So it'll fly to the other side. This is what we thought about before when we said, okay, that's why all the positive charges go here and the negative here. And it makes the field zero on the inside. But now it doesn't, because that positive charge doesn't build up here. It goes into the battery. Right? And it sends out more positive charge here. So it just flows. That's how the current flow happens. Okay. But here's the interesting part, is the charges should accelerate. Right? Because the E field, E in the wire, you can get, it's just the delta V equals E times the length of the wire, okay? So for wires, you can actually treat them like it's a uniform field. It is the same relationship you'd have if you had two plates separated by like delta by D, you know, and you have a potential difference across. Same thing happens in a wire. Let's not get into the exact details of why, but you get a uniform field in the wire, roughly delta V equals ED, right? But anyway, let's say the charges should accelerate. So what does that mean? So VD should increase. Right? It's like they should start here. I guess it rests when they get from the battery, and they should accelerate across the wire. So what would that mean? That would mean the current isn't even constant. It's like zero current here, and it builds up, and you get current there. But that's not what really happens. We know that the current is constant, but we know that the current is constant and it's proportional to delta V, right? So you apply a bigger field, you get a bigger current, bigger drift velocity, but it's at least constant. What I mean to say here is I is constant and it's the same everywhere and it's uniform. So the question is, what's going on? How is this possibly happening? So let me just clarify. This isn't a conundrum, may have occurred to you, may not have, but I think it's important that we explain why drift velocity is constant.
It also helps us explain what resistance is. Okay,
so here the answer is that delta V drives the carriers, the charge carriers, at a terminal velocity. So for mechanics, do you remember what terminal velocity means? Against, in case you don't remember what terminal velocity means, terminal velocity against resistive forces. Okay, so it's just like when a ball falls through the atmosphere, right? So a ball falls, right? If you drop a ball at first, it accelerates because it's got its weight pulling it down. If it falls through air, through an atmosphere, it's also got a drag force. And eventually, the force pulling it down, the drag force is proportional to actually V squared. So as it speeds up, eventually the drag force matches the weight, stops accelerating, and it hits terminal velocity. Okay, the same thing happens in a wire. As you've got this little charge carrier, say let's pretend it's positive, and you've got F equals QE, but you also have FD, a drag force. Okay, not really a drag force. Not really FD. Simple force, but close enough. You actually have to use something that thinks about how the charge particle accelerates and then bounces off the lattice, sort of, and stops, and accelerates and stops, and accelerates and stops. It's actually kind of stopping, starting, stopping. Okay, so that's really microscopically more accurate, but you can approximate that as basically just a drag force. Okay, so we're at terminal velocity. So then when you apply delta V, you get I constant times R. And the R is because V drift is constant. Okay. I'm sorry, R is constant. All right, because, so you have this constant proportionality between these two. Because you increase delta V, you're increasing the electric field, you're pushing harder, and then you go to a different drag force. So the current does go up because the drift velocity gets higher, but there's a constant proportionality between these two things. Okay, and we're not doing that microscopically. That's like the Drude theory, which we don't have time to do. But maybe you get the idea. More delta V, bigger pushing force, means they go faster, bigger drag force. They're going faster, delta V goes up, I goes up, but then there's some constant that describes this drag effect. All right, and that's R, that's the resistance that we talked about. All right, so now we have this idea of why there is resistance. Let's have a look at what its value is and what you do with it. Okay. And then we'll show you how to calculate resistance. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so the resistance, as you can imagine, it depends on like the microscopic properties of the material, and it's like material lattice and how many electrons there are and how many nuclei and the electronic structure and things like that. So it depends on detailed material properties. Described with, and this is going to annoy you, the word for this, the resistivity. So it's sort of like answering the question with the same question. What's the resistance? Well, it depends on the resistivity. But I will show you sort of the difference is, let's look at the resistance of a wire. All right, so we have a wire like this. It's got cross-sectional area A. It's got length L, okay? what's its resistance in terms of V equals IR?
All right, so you apply some delta V, you're going to get a current proportional, and the constant is R. What is R? R equals this resistivity rho, and we'll define that in a second, times L over A. Okay, that's the resistance of a cylindrical wire. Looks pretty similar to a capacitor, right? Some property of either, well, in the case of a capacitor, it's a property of space. Here it's a property of the material. And then two geometrical terms. So rho times the length of the area. And it's a little bit intuitive. You could say, well, what if it gets longer? Would the resistance go up if it gets longer? Yeah. What if it got narrower? If it got narrower, the resistance would probably go up. Well, narrower means a smaller area. So yeah, it goes up. You have a more resistant material, resistance goes up. So we're not going to drive that, but that's basically, that's how you get the resistance of something. So this resistivity, rho, and it's a constant, and it's in ohm meters. The unit is ohm meters. And here I'm just going to give you some values. So copper, there's a table in your book. We'll give you values as you need them. 1.7 times 10 to the minus 8 ohm meters. You say, that means nothing to me. Well, let me show you some other materials, and then it will still mean nothing to you, but it'll be more to you. Nichrome. Nichrome is a highly resistive metal. So for a metal, it has a high resistance. It also doesn't catch fire, so you use it in heating elements. 1.5 times 10 to the minus 6 ohm meters. So you can see about a factor of 100 between various metals. It's pretty very big variation just for metals. Seawater, when you gulp it down when you're out at the beach, 0.22. What about just pure water? Pure water, 2.4 times 10 to 5. So the difference is this has a bunch of ions in it that can drift. So the resistance is low, the resistivity is low. But if the only ions lying around are hydrogen ion and hydroxide, then that's not nearly as good of a resistance. It's much more resistive than having all these ions and nasty stuff in the water. Sea, water, and pure water. And finally, what if we go all the way to glass? Something that is truly an insulator. 2 times 10 to the 14. Oh my God. So the difference in materials is 22 orders of magnitude. Okay, big difference. So for the person that asked, well, we know what's an insulator, what's a conductor. Yeah, we'll tell you things and we'll give you numbers like this. Not only will you know, you'll know it's true by 22 orders of magnitude. All right, so what we're going to do next week is start circuits with all this information we now have about potential difference, current, resistance, and capacitance. It's all we need. We're going to run with current, with a capacitor, with circuits. I'll see you next week.